I can see something coming through the trees. I think it's coming over the bridge right now.
Wildlife Explorers, and welcome aboard the Wild Asia Monorail. My name is Noelle. I'm going to be your conductor and tour guide today. Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Hi, guys. At the back of the train, I have a fellow tour guide who's going to help me out. He's standing up. This is Chris. He's way in the back. He's waving to you guys. Alrighty, guys. So we are going to get started. Just a couple of rules to touch base on before we get into our journey. I'm going to need everyone, including children, to please remain seated with arms and legs inside the train at all times for your safety and for the safety of our animals. Please also refrain from eating, drinking, or smoking during your journey. The water is always allowed. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to be passing over the lovely Bronx River, which is approximately 24 miles long, beginning at the Kensico Dam in Westchester County,
and is
a flourishing habitat for ducks, turtles, fish, beavers, and all manner of migrating birds. You guys look down, you might be able to see some carp down here. We have a really big carp that I saw down on the right hand side here. And as we round this bend and we'll come up to our first meadow, we're not going to see a whole lot. And that's a beaver.
To our herd of Mongolian wild horses. And we have a treat for you guys. Our baby Mongolian wild horse is out and about today. His name is Naren. He is 3 months old and he's directly in the center next to his mommy here. There he goes. Mongolian wild horses were extinct in nature for quite some time and could only be found in captivity. However, there were several successful reintroductions of these animals to the wilds of China and Mongolia, thanks to herds that were raised in North America as well as various Asian zoos. Many folks might also be noticing there are several differences, both visual and genetic, between a Mongolian wild horse and a domestic horse you might find if you were to visit a farm. Mongolian wild horses are shorter in stature with a stockier build and shorter legs, and they also feature the erect mane that's missing the forelock. For those of you who are unfamiliar with that terminology, forelock references the piece of hair that falls directly over the forehead and eye of a domestic horse, so Mongolian wild horses are in fact missing that feature. Captive breeding of this animal first occurred way back in 1901 with a group of 28 horses. However, we here at the Bronx Zoo acquired our herd in 1902, so about a year later, and have done our very best to maintain that herd ever since that point in time. So a lot of those horses that you saw when we made the initial turn into this exhibit are actually descended from the original herd that we got here at the zoo over 100 years ago. Mongolian wild horses have a long and varied history, dating back over 20,000 years, and are the distinction of being the only true species of wild horse left, as they've never been fully domesticated at any point in time.
The first accounts of Mongolian wild horses come from rock engravings, paintings, and even cave drawings that date back more than 20,000 years. And the first written accounts were from Tibet, sometime around 900 AD. But these horses remained largely unknown and unnamed to the Western world for many years. During an expedition to Central Asia in 1879, a famous Russian explorer and naturalist, Colonel Nikolai Przybylski, encountered the horse in Western Mongolia. Because of his discovery, this species is also known as Przybylski's horse.
Now, folks, we're coming up an incline at this point, but once we finally do reach the top of that hill, we're going to be on the lookout for two endangered species that we have here at the Bronx Zoo: the brow antler deer and the gaur. So we should be coming up on our two species momentarily. Alrighty, guys. So my suggestion to everyone will be, give me 1 second. Yeah, okay. So my suggestion to everyone will be to look to the back fence line and follow your line of sight to the right. Because typically our brow antler deer like to hang out along the back fence line. Hopefully we'll catch up to them in just a moment. The brown antler deer get their name from the look of the male deer's antlers that form a curvature over the forehead and resemble something of a large bushy eyebrow. However, folks, you're going to have to take my word for it. Because today is a ladies' day out, so when we finally do catch up with our deer, you'll notice that you won't see any of the antlers in question. They're classified as vulnerable in their native Cambodia because they consistently lose their wild space to farming and are forced to subsist on agricultural crops which are not a natural staple in their diets. Alrighty, folks, so that's actually
just be a
a wild pig known as the Babarusa, and we'll be catching up to our Babarusa pigs in a moment.
Babarusa.
The Babarusa are native to the Indonesian island of Sulawesi and have a very dark pigmentation and lack of hair, which allows them to blend in seamlessly with their environment of mud, rocks, and dark-colored sediment. To the right-hand side, you're going to see Hillshire, our little juvenile piglet, and his mother, Kathy, a female Babarusa. And to the lower right-hand side, you'll see Fez. He's a male Babarusa with the long tusks. He's running out to the left now, guys, so you might be able to see him. Now, they were actually a little bit under the train, so they were not in the best of viewing positions. But, folks, you're now
there
he
is.
Next to lovely
little
Fez.
Oh, I know those pigs. The tusks will go
so
right
don't startle
into their scroll,
our
and they die.
Ladies.
Yeah, they don't know
you
why.
You guys are going to see Patty and Maxine, our two Asian elephants.
Oh, they do.
She's actually with her zookeeper right now, so we can see her right by the gate here. Make sure you remain seated, guys. We don't want to startle her. Thank you, folks. Now, elephants have a lifespan of roughly about 60 years in the wild. Actually, three of them. around here, and you'll see them again as I round the bend if you look straight back. Those are three of our Formosan sika deer. Formosan sika deer are native to Taiwan, which is formerly a territory known as Formosa. Overhunting and loss of habitat eliminated the last wild herd of Formosan sika deer in the early 1970s, and they could only be found in captivity. However, there have been several successful reintroductions of Formosan sika deer to Taiwan's national parks as well as Taiwanese zoos, and their numbers are currently on the upswing. So we'd love to hear that. It's quite the comeback story. We're also going to be on the lookout for a large white bird. That will be our red-crowned crane. Ooh. The red-crowned crane is a highly endangered crane species. Is native to Siberia, possesses a 7-foot wingspan,
wow,
and has a distinctive reddish balding pattern on top of their head, which is where they get the origin for their name. This one is a female here. We have her down here on the lower right-hand side. And if you finally look up on top of the hill, you're going to see three large tailed animals back there. Those are the Nilgai antelope. The Nilgai antelope are the largest and fastest antelope species in Asia, with the capability of exceeding speeds of 50 miles per hour when they run. The word Nilgai in the Hindi language means blue bull. And that's in reference to the distinctive grayish blue coating that the male will obtain upon maturity. You'll see a little brown deer down here. That's one of our Chinese tufted deer. Chinese tufted deer are highly elusive species and very small. They weigh only about 40 pounds to be grown. They get their name from a tuft of hair that grows out of the top of their foreheads and covers up their antlers. And an interesting fact about them is that when they find a situation that makes them feel stressed, threatened, or endangered, we have another one sitting down on the rocks to the right, they will bark, whistle, or even growl, much like a dog. Very rare to see in zoos outside of China, so we at the Bronx Zoo are very happy and lucky to have them here. And as we round this bend, in a moment, we're all going to be at the highest elevation point in our tour, 35 feet over the beautiful Bronx River. And if you folks like to take pictures as much as I know I do, we are going to have a marvelous photo opportunity available to you right about now. So please enjoy. There's some ducks right out in the center of the river there. Personally, thank you guys for being here, taking time out of your busy schedule to support us. kiosks and inquires to what steps you would need to take in order to obtain a WCS membership. WCS members enjoy free rides and attractions, free parking passes, free amenities, a commemorative t-shirt, and free entry to all five parks for an entire calendar year, and much, much more. Now, ladies and gentlemen, in just a couple of seconds, I'm going to stop the train. However, this is not the final stop on the tour, so I'll ask that everyone please remain seated. I just need to allow my computer to reset for the following tour, which should take all of a couple of seconds, and then I'll be able to send everyone to the platform and get everybody on their way. Now, just a heads up for everyone, the Bronx Zoo will be closing at 5 o'clock this evening. However, everything containing live animals should be strictly put away at 4:30. So the only thing that will be open between 4:30 and 5 o'clock will be the 4D gear, the bug carousel, the zoo shuttle, excuse me, not the zoo shuttle, folks, actually the zoo gift shops, I have to say, and I suppose the restaurants, they do not contain live animals, so plan to stay day accordingly, ladies and gentlemen. And with that, I'm going to get everybody moving again.
It was good. You saw a lot of nice animals.
On behalf of the Wildlife Conservation Society, myself, Noelle, and my partner, Phil Atorga,